Hello audience, Mr. Z here. South Africa, a bountiful land of natural resources, rich ports, and booming industry. Or at least it was. Picturesque visages of South Africa's vintage cities on the rise are but a relic of the past. Today being the site of high inflation, high crime rates, and a shrinking job market, in addition to many farmers living in fear for their lives, as the government sanctions violent land seizures. Of course, in contrast, those who argue against the past oppose the oppressive regime of South Africa's apartheid government. Apartheid being South Africa's segregation system, which functioned to preserve the rule of the post-colonial white minority government, while also dividing communities along racial lines in the name of self-determination, leading to the establishment of Bantustans, or black homelands for the native populations, four of which had become in essence their own autonomous states, though designed to be economically and resource-dependent upon the South African government. Apartheid would come to be labeled by the International United Nations Committee as a crime against humanity, beginning an era of extensive embargoes, which in the height of the Cold War, with the Soviets eyeing Africa as a hotbed for communism to arise, would leave South Africa vulnerable to a number of communist organizations and sympathizers who would radicalize peaceful anti-apartheid movements. The major turning point from non-violence to terrorist activity came in the wake of the Sharpeville massacre, where multiple thousands of protesters had offered themselves up to a police department for violating identification law. Of course, the police couldn't arrest all of them, so the protest had succeeded, at first. Only 20 officers had been stationed at the department while the crowd grew to a massive 20,000 protesters. The success of the protest led to initial celebrations, which quickly became rowdier, and the mood of the protest quickly turned ugly and aggressive. Armored personnel carriers were called in to form a barricade while the officers attempted to disperse the crowd from the streets, but only riled them up further. In a move to scatter the protesters, jets were called in to fly only a few hundred feet from the ground, hoping this would scare the group into scattering, only inciting the protesters to begin hurling stones at the officers, who in retaliation deployed tear gas, yet again, not deterring the crowd, which would begin advancing on the officers. Officers attempted to arrest one of the stone-throwing men, but he resisted and the crowd joined in, grabbing at the officers and leading one in a state of panic to fire shots off into the crowd. Alarmed by the shot and afraid the protesters were armed, the other officers who were oblivious of the situation opened fire on the protesters, leading to a death toll of 69. It was from this point forward that resistance movements within South Africa took up a militant cause, leading to a growing civilian casualty count in the years which followed, until 1991. The Soviet Union had collapsed. Communist insurgencies had lost their main source of financial support, while the South African government could no longer justify apartheid as necessary to preventing the spread of communism. So, both sides were forced to negotiate. In our timeline, though apartheid was ended and the communists seemed defeated, the decades which followed South Africa's transformation would not be constructive ones. While segregation was ended and the black majority gained the right to vote, the communists were far from finished. No longer being able to take up arms, many took rank in the African National Congress, or ANC, which has held a long-standing alliance with the South African Communist Party, itself being a member of Socialist International, and has remained the ruling party since 1994. Today the nation is a mess. Civil unrest with the seemingly incompetent government grows by the year, protests no longer seem to take a peaceful character, and in an apparent role reversal, it is now the native majority oppressing the white poor minority in the nation. Aside from that, it seems all that's changed is everyone has gotten poorer. But today we're going to ask, what if things had gone differently? What if the end of apartheid also marked the end of South Africa? What if in addition to the collapse of the Soviet Union and Yugoslavia in 1991, we also saw the breakup of the South African state, a balkanization situation actually very similar to what happened to Yugoslavia? See, the years which followed the end of apartheid saw the mass exodus of white citizens who felt their vote as a minority no longer counted, and that their security could no longer be assured. Of those who remained, many felt determined to preserve regional autonomy, leading to a number of calls for secession to create an independent Boer state, and even an attempted coup to restore white rule in the late 90s to early 2000s. A number of other ethnic groups distinct from the majority Bantu population have also put forward requests for independence, such as the Sovereign State of Good Hope. Even according to the South African Constitution, communities and ethnic groups are afforded the right to self-determination, a provision which was adopted upon the transitioning away from apartheid, indicating that some of the people in government did consider the breakup of the country along ethnic lines post-apartheid. We're going to suggest that in this timeline, that's precisely what happens. The abolishment of apartheid would go hand in hand with a series of independence referendums, culminating in a division of South Africa into five new ethnic republics. the West Cape Republic, the Third Boer Republic, the Republic of Transkei, as well as the republics of KwaZulu and Sotho. Some of these being fully realized sovereign and self-sufficient successors to the original Bantustans. As had been policy for the Bantustans in our timeline, individuals of backgrounds outside of the regulated state would not be guaranteed voting rights until they relocated to the state in which they belonged, stimulating a forced migration which would become the controversy of world media. Yet South African officials would cite that there are little differences between these actions and the partitioning of India to create the exclusively Islamic Republic of Pakistan, separate from India's Hindu population. Despite this, we may once again see certain nations limit trade or impose penalties upon the newly formed South African republics, most specifically the Third Boer Republic, which would retain the government of the apartheid era, specifically President de Klerk, who had released Mandela as well as other political prisoners and made the initial efforts toward ending apartheid. De Klerk only having been appointed president after the resignation of former President Botha in the wake of his declining health. Transkei would become the new operational hub for the African National Congress and move in the same direction South Africa had gone in our timeline. Mandela would most likely be elected their leader in the years to follow, building relations between his own and de Klerk's government, while also exerting military influence over KwaZulu, making it in the years to come little more than a puppet state. Internationally, South Africa's division along ethnic lines would be met with mixed reactions, but most concerningly would set a precedence in the West for race relations. A resolution of total separation, which seemingly died in the war with integration during the civil rights era, was suddenly revived. Why this is important is because the 90s were a sensitive time for American race relations, specifically in the years that followed the 1992 LA riots. While the breakup of the Soviet Union and Yugoslavia were easily dismissible as completely the cause of communism and distinct enough from race to disregard, the case for South Africa wasn't. It would be a first world Western nation breaking apart because of heightened internal racial disputes. So suddenly, this becomes a plausible direction in the minds of ethnically conscious Americans, especially as the US, once it's finished celebrating the defeat of the USSR, now must deal with the pressures of being the sole global superpower, in what could be regarded as one of the most turbulent decades of American history. Back in South Africa, de Klerk's negotiations had successfully lifted any remaining sanctions on the Boer Republic, yet despite this and the achievements of self-determination, some of the more radical Afrikaners would not be satisfied with the president and his very outspoken friendship with the ANC of Transkei, a party whose name had come to become synonymous with terrorism, specifically against white citizens. It didn't help the case that de Klerk, despite being a member of the more right-wing National Party, would commonly parrot the platform of the Liberal Democratic Party, and we could assume in this timeline this would translate to a number of liberal policies and agreements made with Transkei's ANC, which could seemingly attempt to re-merge the two states by dissolving their borders and allowing for cross-national elections, thus leading a coup to be launched by radical members of the Nationalist Party to remove de Klerk from office and reverse the policies he had made with Transkei, who stood to benefit significantly from the businesses and skilled labor coming in from the Boer Republic. Not being willing to lose these benefits, Transkei would threaten military intervention to overthrow what they deemed an illegitimate government, ultimately sparking a war between the Boers and the Transkei, which would certainly spill over into neighboring states and mirror the brutal events of the Yugoslav Wars, taking the brief renaissance these new nations would have seen and plunging them back into darkness. The US would potentially involve itself in a move to maintain stability in the West as it had done in Bosnia and later Kosovo, supporting Transkei on the account of its liberal democratic policies in contrast to the seemingly fascistic new National Party leadership. However, in doing so, the US would rile up racial tensions back at home even more, and the same could be said if the US would have chosen to support the Boers instead, because the conflict would squarely be painted as a war between a white nation and a black nation on the grounds of ethnic interest. Involvement on either side would be heavily polarizing, contributing to the civil unrest already brewing within the nation, and potentially leading the US, as South Africa had become to Yugoslavia, a parallel of the USSR, in an inevitable collapse. And that is where I'll end this video for now. The US of Z, thanks for watching. Support your Legion by liking the video, or join our ranks by subscribing for more. Mr. Z, out.